to build in London. Please give it up for Tom Daley. Hey. Hi, take a seat, take a seat.
Got a microphone and everything.
Get up. You in?
Oh gosh, yeah, just about. Good. These, you know, like they're like proper director's chairs, these, aren't they?
I mean, it's a bit. Are you stable?
Yeah, okay. Just about.
Well, thank you Hopefully. So much for joining us today.
No, thank you for having me.
For our audience here, if you've got any questions or if you're at home and want to ask Tom anything, please just tweet us at Build Series London. So, your book,
yes,
the year, it's just broke into Amazon Top 10,
yes.
Tom's Daily Plan.
Yeah.
Can you just tell us a bit about it? What inspired the book?
Yeah, well, it all started really from last year. I started really taking over my YouTube channel and wanting to, you know, all the things I've learned from diving and the health and fitness tips that I've learned over the years and trying to pass that on to other people and make it a bit more accessible. So I've done workout routines on my channel, life hacks, for example, like the things like lemon water, how you can save on calories with drinking black coffee instead of regular coffee, tips with sleeping, goal setting. And then the conversation of a book came up and it was a really exciting prospect for me because I've always been a massive fan of food. If I'm not diving or sleeping, I'm usually eating. And from as young as I can remember, whenever I went to my grandma and granddad's house, we'd always bake cakes. Me and my brothers, we'd learn how to bake cakes and then we'd argue over who got to lick the bowl and all that kind of stuff. And then it went on to like learning how to make soups and then learning how to make a pasta bake. And the actual recipe for the pasta bake that I first learned to make with my grandma is in there. So my grandma's pasta broccoli bake is in there.
Oh, respect to the grandma.
I know, exactly. And it's just, so then for an athlete, food is fuel. And I think people underestimate the importance of what you're eating and how it can give you the brain power that you need to be able to function, not just as an athlete, but in work, in school, wherever it is. And also not just the physical well-being, but also mental health too.
Yeah, definitely. And I think the audience just saw a picture of the pancakes that I made yesterday. They are...
Not bad. That's not bad at all.
They are Tom's banana and blueberry pancakes.
Yeah.
They probably don't look as good as Tom's in his book, but they were delicious nonetheless. So that pancake is just, you know, one of 80 recipes.
Yeah.
Where did you get all your ideas from?
So I eat a wide variety of stuff. And I think lots of people don't necessarily know about me is that I enjoy cooking. I went to cookery school when I was 16 for 6 weeks. And have all, like whenever I come home from training, I just find it so therapeutic to switch the music on and just start cooking. Because, you know, as an athlete, it's so important to make sure that you eat well. And for people that are just going to work or going to school, whatever it is, having that healthy routine and not feeling like you're on a diet, because I think the word diet, people automatically feel like they're going to fail and feel like, oh, no, there's no way that I'm going to be able to maintain that. Whereas all the recipes in Tom's Daily Plan are very much things that you can grab on the way home. You can grab them from your local corner shop. You don't have to go to a specialist store to find any ingredients in particular. So, and they're things that you'd want to eat. It's not like a boiled piece of chicken and a steamed piece of broccoli. It's like things that you can enjoy as with a family, with your friends, good things for dinner parties, weekend treats. And there's lots of breakfast things in there because I'm a massive fan of breakfast.
Well, and your bacon sandwiches, of course.
Oh, yeah, exactly. There's bacon sandwiches, there's huevos rancheros, there's baked eggs, scrambled eggs, all kinds of different things for breakfast. And then lunch, and also some of my mum's sausage casseroles in there as well, which is like my all-time favourite thing.
Some family favourites in there that are on the go. I mean, you mentioned spending time with family as well.
Yes.
And how it's important for you to spend time whilst eating with family and get together. Mm-hmm. How do you find time to do that? I mean, you've got such a busy schedule and you're training and traveling. How do you get time to fit that in?
I mean, it is quite hard, especially with, I mean, I'm training 6 hours a day, 6 days a week. So it becomes quite difficult to try and fit in time to go and see friends and family and stuff. But I've got such a supportive group of friends and family. And, you know, they know that if they ever come over to mine after work, they're going to get fed. So, and food is a massive motivator, funnily enough. And I try to get home to Plymouth as often as I can to go and see, like, my mum, my grandparents and my friends back there. But, you know, it's tough when you only get Saturday afternoon and Sunday off, traveling down to Plymouth for 4 hours, and then you only get to be there for 24 hours and then coming back. can be quite difficult.
But come see me and I'll cook for you.
Yeah, exactly. But my mum does come up quite often. She likes coming up to London because every time she comes up, we go see a show and, you know, all that kind of stuff. She likes London. Yes, it's good.
So you also say that you and Lance make time to eat together, spend time together. But who is the better chef?
Me, definitely.
Would he say the same?
Well, the thing is, we're both good at different things. He's very good at the, you know, Southern American comfort food kind of thing. So like the fried chicken, he's really good on the barbecue. So in the summer, that's like really handy, but he doesn't necessarily know how to cook the healthiest of meals. So so I tend to do most of the cooking. I'm in charge of breakfast and I'm in charge of dinner. He figures out his own lunch because I'm at the pool all day. So yeah, basically I cook, except from the summer, because he'll do some stuff on the barbecue and fried chicken when I get home from competition sometimes.
I mean, that sounds a good system.
Yeah, no, it works. And it's important, I think, for everyone. I think so many people eat on the go and it's like, oh, I'll just grab dinner when I can get it or whatever. But actually making time to spend time with your friends and family over dinner is I think so many people have so many memories from sitting down with friends or family, wherever it may be, or whenever it was. You build memories around food, I think.
Now, back to the book. Yes. For me, it's quite a holistic approach to well-being rather than just focusing on fitness or on food. What was the thought process behind that?
Well, the whole idea of Tom's Daily Plan was not just to have lots of recipes in it, because I think there's lots of books out there with loads of different recipes, and also ones that, you know, have the recipes and fitness routines. But all the fitness routines in there, for one, are 20 minutes long, and you don't need a gym membership, you don't need any equipment whatsoever, you can do them all at home. There's different levels, beginner, intermediate, advanced, and even moderations that you can make depending on if you've got certain injuries. There's all different kinds of stretches in there. And then also more lifestyle stuff and things that I've learned over the years that help me. So like goal setting, meditation, because I do 10 minutes of meditation every single morning. Things like lemon water, things like how you can help with getting to sleep easier. So it's because if you think about health in general, it's not just about making sure you're going to the gym or making sure that you're eating the right things. I think people disregard mental health quite a lot. And I think having those aspects in a book that's got recipes and workouts in them at the same time, I think it can help you just adjust to a healthier lifestyle.
Yeah, definitely. And, you know, the life hacks, like you say, setting goals, boosting energy, it's essentially advice to help us with our mental health. So who would you say gives you your advice?
I've had a lot of advice from lots of different people throughout the years of as a diver. And I've had to learn the hard way quite often when it comes to food, when it comes to psychological preparation, when it comes to the different ways that my body likes to work out and things that work and things that don't work. So I've had to learn a lot over the years through my various coaches, strength and conditioning coaches, diving coaches, sports psychologists, sports nutritionists, all those different things, because it was only really in the last 3 years that I got my nutrition on the right track. Because before that, I mean, until you're about 16, you can kind of eat, like, you was kind of eating whatever I wanted, and it didn't really matter because I was training for 6 hours a day. But then there was like a turning point where it was like, oh, I can't really eat that, because then it start like ballooning. So I then started to really focus on what I needed to eat, and I had no nutrition advice. So the first thing that I did was I cut out carbs completely. And as an athlete, that is the worst thing that you can do. And that was something that I learned the hard way. And that's why I worry about lots of the fad diets that you see online and see in the newspapers of like, you need to cut this food group, cut that food group. Because if you start cutting food groups, all you do is crave that. And I think it's just having everything in moderation can be good. Like, I've got sweet treats in there as well. It's not just about making sure that you don't eat any sugar whatsoever. There are things that you can do. And if you're working out and the right portion sizes, you can have everything in moderation.
And you said Mythbusters, so you can eat fast food just in moderation, and although that was probably the greatest thing that I read in there.
Yeah, because if you, like, the thing is, if you say to yourself, you're never ever gonna be allowed to, well, for me, if someone said to me, you're never allowed to eat cheesecake ever again, all I'm gonna do is like hunt down cheesecake and like smell it and just want to be, you know, want to inhale the cheesecake. But I think if you could tell yourself that you can have that every now and then, it's okay. But one thing in there as well is the fact that lots of people have a cheat day where they don't do any exercise and they eat whatever they want. And that's probably the worst thing that you can do, is have a cheat day and eat what you want when you're not exercising. You're better off having a treat on a day that you've done some exercise, so your body is actually burning off the calories rather than just letting it sit there. Because I've done a food, again, it was something that I learned the hard way. I did a food diary where I was eating, like registering, like I'm writing down all the different things that I was eating throughout the week. And it turned out that the carbohydrate and sugar intake that I had on a Sunday was the equivalent to the first 4 days of the week combined. Because I had like a roast, because I thought, oh, I'll have a cheat day. So I had a roast dinner, and then I had like three desserts. And then I was like, oh, well, that's probably not the right thing to do. So I've had to learn a lot through just making mistakes and learning along the way what works for me.
I want to also talk about meditation, which you brought up a bit while ago, and how in your book you say that it wasn't for you straight away, but now it's a part of your daily routine. So what was the turning point that you actually really started to get into it?
Well, it was actually really from the beginning of this year, because I was told to do it like a year and a half ago or even more. And I was a bit like, I was a bit of a skeptic. I was like thinking, really, does sitting there with your eyes closed for 10 minutes, focusing on your breathing, is that really going to help? And so I started doing it in January. I was like, okay, fine, I'm just going to start doing it. And it was unbelievable the way that it made me feel a lot calmer. Like stress levels went down, anxiety went away, and being able to just know that you can sit there for 10 minutes and just have time for yourself in the morning, in the afternoon, in a lunch break, whenever it may be, just to sit there and have time for yourself and know that with all the thoughts that are going around in your head and all the like clouds, if you like, above that is always blue sky, and being able to go to that place and being able to, and I didn't get there straight away. Like for the first, I don't know, it must have been about 2 or 3 weeks, I would sit there and then I'd be thinking about, what am I going to do next? What's happening tomorrow? What am I going to do? And it takes you a while to be able to just shut all of that out and just focus on just being in the moment. And that's something that I've learned going into competitions and various different things in life in general, is the fact about being in the moment and focusing on what you can do right now to be the best you tomorrow.
Have you had to use meditation during wedding preparations?
So far, so good. So no meditation for that side of thing. Although it does help, I guess. Help you have a little bit more process about things. But, you know, it's all very exciting.
What can you tell us? How's the planning going? Obviously, the wedding this year. Exactly. What's going on?
Well, I mean, there's lots going on and it's very exciting, but I'm going to keep it all under wraps for now, I'm afraid.
Okay.
Oh, sorry, so, sorry.
Well, even if you talk about stag do's, has that been planned yet?
I mean, it's hard to have a stag do as an athlete because I'm training all the time, so I don't really drink. So having like a, and if I was to say to my best man is Sam, and I took him on a stag do and we went on this like booze cruise thing, and I tried to get him to drink water. He lasted 45 minutes with him and his friends. And I was like saying to his friends, no, don't make him drink that. Don't, no, because we're going to have to all go home. And yeah, so we were home by about 10:30.
I mean,
yeah, no, I was like, great, early night for me. But it was, yeah, so I know that if he was to organize something, and I said to him, yeah, well, Les, why don't we just go away for a nice like spa weekend or something? He'd be like, yeah, right, okay. So, yeah, I don't know what's going to happen.
Watch this space.
Yeah, watch the space, yeah.
Okay, I'm going to change tack slightly now, because I want to talk to you about how you, in recent years, you've been an LGBT advocate and, you know, you're patron of Switchboard, and you've been celebrated with lots of awards for your work in that area. In terms of the Olympics, in recent years, there's been a lot of controversy with the event taking place in countries which have laws which are progressive against LGBT rights. But having said that, in Rio 2016, it was a record Olympics, the amount of out publicly LGBT athletes.
Yeah, and it turns out Team GB has the most number of out LGBT athletes out of any of the countries. So it's, you know, who knew? Who knew Team GB was so good? Yeah, it was, I know, I think it's gradually, you know, sport can be quite a difficult and daunting place to think that you can just come out and be yourself. And especially with people in team sports, there's still, although lots of laws have changed in the last 50 years, because it's 50 years this year since the decriminalization of being gay. So lots of laws have changed between then and now, but still people's minds and people's thoughts and people, the way people think about it is still to be changed, really. And I think in the coming years, with people being more comfortable being able to share who they are and tell their own stories, because if you can tell your own story and change, you know, get to somebody's heart, then that can help change minds as well.
Definitely. And do you think that you coming out has helped influence other athletes feel more confident to come out themselves?
I mean, coming out on YouTube, it wasn't something that I thought about at any of that. It was kind of like there was lots of questions all the time, and it was just being able to just like get the weight off my shoulders, just be like, you know what, like here it is, here's what I'm going to say, and that's what I'm going to say about it. It felt like the right thing to do at the time. And I mean, since then, I've felt so, you know, honored that people have come up to me and like say things like, oh, because of your video, I've been able to tell my parents, my parents have been okay with it. Or even little things like parents saying to their kids things like, oh, wow, like he's been able to, how brave, what, and things like that, which then makes them feel comfortable enough to be able to say, well, you know, I might feel like that too. And it is a scary time for anyone going through that, but it's, you know, it does get easier.
Okay, on Olympics,
yes.
Tokyo 2020.
Yes.
I know it's a long way off, but I know training is already in motion.
Yes.
How's it going?
Yeah, good. I came from training this morning, although the tube strike was a little bit of a nightmare to get there. So, you know, I'm sure everybody has felt the pain of that today. But yeah, the training's going really well, and it's exciting actually going into 2020 because there might be two new diving events put into the Olympics. And that's the mixed synchro events. And I compete in both mixed synchro events and also the team event. So it's interesting. Going to be interesting. In September, I think they announce whether it's going to be in the Olympics or not. And then that'll be another two great events that are medal prospects for Team GB. And that's something that I'm going to focus on this year, is the mixed synchro, which is basically I would dive with a female diver on the springboard and also a female diver on the platform as well.
So, I mean, I was going to ask you, you know, you've done so many Olympics now. Does it get a bit same old, same old? like now there could be new routines. I guess that completely mixes it up.
I think whenever any athlete gets told that they've made an Olympic team, I don't think that moment will ever get old. And I think it's really hard to explain, but the only thing that the way I can explain it is the fact that you train for 4 years, 6 days a week, 6 hours a day, just to qualify for those Olympic Games. And you do all of that training, all those hours of preparation, and it comes down to one day, and it comes down to six dives, and it's the most pressurized environment that you could possibly imagine. And it's only because you see those five rings on the wall can make a massive difference to the way you think, the way you feel. And it's just a lot of training for that one moment, but that's why it's so special for so many athletes to come away with a medal.
Absolutely. So I know we got the World Championships this year,
yes.
But aside from seeing you in diving, we all loved you in Splash, didn't we? We all want to know, will we be seeing you on our TV screens?
I mean, I don't know. I love Splash. I had so much fun doing that. And it's just getting closer to the Olympics, being able to commit to, you know, 10 Saturdays or 8 Saturdays or whatever it was, because it started getting into competition season earlier as I was getting closer to the Olympics. So it's, you know, it's rested is what they said.
TBC.
Not decommissioned, rested.
TBC.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, well, I think we've got some questions from your fans in the audience.
Ooh.
Who has got the first question?
If you could have any non-diving celeb as your diving partner, who would it be?
Oh. Non-diving celeb as a dive partner, Shawn Mendes, I think.
Why?
I mean, why? I mean, why not? I don't know if that was the right answer you were looking for, but yeah, I think it would be fun.
So it appears you've got diving pretty sorted, but if you could be any other kind of athlete, what would you be?
I have always wanted to do something like bobsleigh or skeleton in the Winter Olympics. I think it'd be so much fun. I'm a bit of an adrenaline junkie. When it comes to skydive, bungee jump, you name it, I'll do it. So I'm a bit weird like that, which is why I enjoy the adrenaline rush of being up on a 10-meter board. So to kind of push that, like who knows, maybe 2022, I'll give the Winter Olympics a go instead.
I mean, that, or you could just go on the jump.
Oh, God, that looks like the scariest show ever, but I mean, it could be fun.
Anyone else?
Hi, we've got a couple of questions from social media.
Yes.
What kind of music do you listen to before training to get yourself pumped up?
It does vary massively. Usually my coach puts on her music and she has the most varied taste in music, as you can imagine. Sometimes it's Bee Gees, sometimes it's Michael Jackson, sometimes it's Clean Bandit. Like, it's so varied. She literally just puts her iPod on shuffle and occasionally she's like, oh no, that's my bath time music. And it's like this like really like slow stuff that comes on randomly, which is a bit weird. But yeah, it's a variety of things, but usually upbeat stuff, no bath music.
Okay, cool. And we've got another one, which is, do you have a lucky pair of swimming trunks?
No lucky pair of swimming trunks, but I do have a lucky monkey. When I was about 9 years old, I used to hate staying away from home. And I always used to say, I'm not going to go unless I get a monkey. And so my parents at the time were like, yeah, if you stay, we'll get you a monkey. No problem. I was like, and a trampoline. And they were like, okay. So I went away for this diving training camp and then came back excited to think that I was going to have a monkey and a trampoline. But I come home and I've got this like orange monkey with like Velcro hands and a, you know, one of those little like aerobics trampoline things. So I came back to those two, which was quite interesting. And they were like, well, we stuck to our promise. You didn't say a real monkey. You just said a monkey. But since then, I've had it and it goes to every single competition with me, all the way up until the Olympics, the last one. I know it's weird. It just sits in my bag with its head popping out the bag.
Well, fingers crossed that works for Tokyo 2020.
Fingers crossed.
I'm afraid we're out of time now. Tom, thank you so much for joining
us. No problem at all. Thank you for having me.
Daley!